And the Bible tells us that yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become what? Children of God. So I don't care what your past is. I don't care what you have been through. I don't care your situations and circumstances in life. God is willing and is prepared this morning to take you on as his child.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Now, when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up and saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and asked, "Are you for us or for our enemies?" "Neither," he replied, "but as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come." Then Joshua fell face down to the ground in reverence and asked him, "What message does my Lord have for his servant?" The commander of the Lord's army replied, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy." And Joshua did so. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to be in your presence, to come before the throne, to listen to you. Heavenly Father, as you minister to us, we pray in Jesus' name that both the bearer of the words and the hearer of the words, Father, you bless. And the words that will be spoken this morning, Father, will be manifested in our lives and used for our growth, Lord. Father, we pray that you meet with us as you minister to us this morning. We pray that by your grace, you distribute yourself among us for your glory, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Joshua had just taken over the leadership of the Israelites. Remember, the Israelites have been, up to the time that Joshua took over, they had been wandering around for about 40 years. From their journey, from the time they left Egypt, crossed the Red Sea, they were on this journey. They had all the time known Moses as the leader. And he was no longer there, and Joshua took over. They were near the promised land. Moses saw the promised land, but God told him, "You will see it, but you will not enter it." And it was down to a new leader to take the children of Israelites, to take the Israelites right into the promised land. Actually, at this point where Joshua, from the passage I read earlier on, at this time, some of the Israelites had already been in their promised land because they had been allocated part of the eastern side of the River Jordan, and the rest will cross over to the other side. So for 40 years, Israelites had wandered across the desert. They were near the promised land. For some, they were already on their promised land. But for some, they still had a journey to make. And it is also the same for us. For those that are already confessed, that have already confessed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we are continuing on our journey. So for the 2.5 tribes, you remember there are 12 tribes of Israel. For the two and a half tribes that were already allocated the eastern side of the Jordan, their journey, you think, was ended. But Joshua, as we read on, Joshua told them that the armed men have to come across. They have to cross over to help the other 9.5 to settle down. So when, as you sit here this morning, already confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, already accepted Him as the beginning and the end of your life, you are still on a journey. It's not ended. Let's look across our streets. Look across the street where you live. Look at the people that you work with. Look at your family. There are still many people that are not saved. Therefore, the journey is not ended. It's a continuing progress. It's a continuing journey. Until we see our families, until we see our friends, until we see our neighbors accept Lord as their Savior, we are on a journey. We might have been there, we might have accepted Lord, but it's continuing for us. We have a work to do. We have a people to speak to. We have a people to bring to the kingdom. And the armed men from the 2.5 tribes of Israel, in a way, can be said to have reached their promised land. But Joshua said, you have to come along with us because there's something to be taken. There's land to be captured. There are people to be settled. And that's a message for us this morning. The field is wide open. The population of the United Kingdom, 60 million, 65 million. And how many truly accept Jesus as Lord and Savior? So you are sitting here this morning and thinking, I have accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. That is not the end, my brothers and sisters. That actually is the beginning of your journey. It's the beginning of your relationship with Him. Because when Jesus left the world, He commissioned His disciples. And you are His disciples as well. He said, go out into what? Into the world. So wherever you may be, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you have a responsibility, you have a duty to ensure that you speak of the good news, you speak of deliverance into people's lives. I'm not standing here this morning and thinking it is easy. I'm not standing here this morning and thinking you just talk to people and everything will be okay. I have known people that have been disciplined because of their faith, because they have the courage to speak of God's kingdom. But because the powers of this world are against us, it's not an excuse for us to stop from doing what God is asking of us, from doing what God is asking of you and is asking of me. Our passage is taken from Joshua chapter 6. And I'll repeat the passage I read, part of the passage I read earlier on, which is chapter 5, verse 15. The commander of the Lord's army replied, "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy." We, as children of God, need to be in obedience to what God is saying to us. Because as father, as mother, as brother, as sister, we need the grace of God in the things that we do. Here, Joshua was just taking over the responsibility for leading the children of Israel. And he bowed down. And he fell on his face in total submission to God. And that needs to be first and foremost our desire at all times. To fall down, face down in total submission to God's authority. The children or the responsibilities that we have, it's not because we just found it like that. The children that you have as a parent, they are given to you to mentor, to bring up under God's guidance. And you need God's grace to be able to do the work properly. Children, I'm sure we've all been children before. And I remember a while ago when I was still young. I'm still young, relatively young. And I used to be trouble for my dad. And I'm sure my children will be trouble for me. Well, they're already trouble anyway. But we need God's grace to be able to bring them up the right way. And to do that, we need to be in total submission to God's words in our lives. For God's direction, we need to bring everything before God. And the mission for the children of Israel was to take Jericho. Now, Jericho was tightly shut because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in. Total shut down. You remember, in the course of this last week, there was an army major in America that killed 13 people. And I remember, in the course of the day, news item came through to say there was total lockout. Lockdown, thank you. No vehicle was allowed in, no vehicle was allowed out. Everything was just like that, stand still. You are not allowed in. And this was the situation that Jericho was in. They had heard what God had done in the past with the Egyptians as they crossed the Red Sea, all the kings that they have come across, how God had dealt with them. And they thought, these people are coming here. We need to be prepared for them. And the best way we can be prepared for them is to have a total shutdown. No one comes into our city and no one goes out. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men." What I want to bring out of this, the war had not started, the battle had not been fought, but God was already pronouncing that, "I have delivered the city into your hand." And in a way, let's look at it from where we are standing today. We see all things ranged against us. Day by day, we are being outnumbered. We see war being fought and Christians being killed right across the world. And this is reassuring. The Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hand." And this is a message that we need to take out, that we need to take with us. Because God has already done the work for us. We need to go out and reap the fruit of that work. When God places you in a situation, when God places you at your place of work, when God asks you, "This is where I want to work," why is it that when you are looking for work, you said, "God, please direct me where you think I'll be useful"? It's because what you are indirectly asking God is, "Where I will be your messenger, where I can speak your words of deliverance, where I can bring people to the kingdom." And when God places you there, God is already telling you, "The field is for you. I want harvest." But what do we do when we get there? We keep low profile. "I don't want to be known as Christian. I'll just go to work and come back home. My family is fine. That's the important thing. I don't want to rock the boat." Isn't that our attitude? But here God is saying, "Look, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. When you hear them sound a long blast on the trumpets, have all the people give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse and the people will go up, every man straight in." What a wonderful message. What a reassuring message. That they didn't even have to do much other than to march. The city was already gifted to the children of Israel. It was already gifted. So whatever obstacle that had been placed there was useless. And for me, the message I'm bringing here this morning is, whatever obstacle that had been placed there, as you seek to bring people to the kingdom, those obstacles are useless. Because try and imagine it. It's like the poor me standing here and an armored car made, everything is still, and the poor me standing in front of it. What hope have I got? You have the Almighty God, the creator of the heaven and earth, right behind you, standing with you, walking alongside you. And urging you to go on, to move on, to step forward, to claim ground. And you are pulling back. You've already got the gift. So he said, when they heard the long blast on the trumpet, have all people give a loud shout, then the wall of the city will collapse. So Joshua, son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take up the ark of the covenant of the Lord and have seven priests carry trumpets in front of it. And he ordered the people, advance, march around the city with the armed guard going ahead of the ark of the Lord. When Joshua had spoken to the people, the seven priests carrying the seven trumpets before the Lord went forward blowing their trumpets, and the ark of the Lord's covenant followed them. The armed guard marched ahead of the priest who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard followed the ark. All this time the trumpets were sounding. You see here that in the directive that had been given to the children of Israel, there was nothing about fighting. It was about marching. Once a day, for 6 days, marching around the city. What this tells us, this particular passage signifies that the Lord Himself was there. It's telling us about the leadership of God in the military expedition. He was present there. He was there. And there are many things that tells us about God's presence. The ram's horn is usually brought out for religious occasion. The Ark of the Covenant, which signifies God's presence, was present. Even though the army was there, they participated. It is God's divine work that the war will be brought down. And that it will not allow any obstacle to withstand the onward movement of his people. Of his people into their divine inheritance. He had promised the land to them. And nothing was going to stop his children from taking hold of that inheritance. So, going back to my earlier question, if when we want work, either you come out to the front here for someone to pray with you, or you talk to God in the privacy of your own home, or whichever way that you talk to God, Father, I want your will be done concerning this interview that I'm going for. You are asking not because, yeah, I know the monetary aspect is right. You want to be paid for the work that you're doing. But I believe essentially what you are actually saying is, I want you, if this job is your will for me, let me get it. And God's will is that you do his desire, that you bring people to the kingdom. And when he gives you that job, he's essentially saying, I have placed you there as my prefect, if you like. I remember in secondary school, used to have prefects, head boy, health prefect, food prefect, everything prefect. And they are the eyes, the ears, and the eyes of the people in authority. And that is the same thing here. And when that job is given to us, it signifies the Lord's desire that you go out there and be there and sow seeds and bring in harvests and bring people to the kingdom. Let's go to verse 10. But Joshua had commanded the people, "Do not give a cry, do not raise your voices, do not say a word until the day I tell you to shout. Then shout." So he had the ark of the Lord carried around the city, cycling it once. Then the people returned to the camp and spent the night there. Joshua got up early the next day, and the priest took up the ark of the Lord, the seven priests carrying, and it continues like that for six days. For 6 days. Let's move to verse 15. On the seventh day, they got up at daybreak and marched around the city seven times in the same manner, except that on that day, they cycled the city seven times. There are a number of people that have placed some significance around this. Going back to creation, God worked in 6 days, and on the seventh day rested. The work is to be done for 6 days, and the battle is won on the seventh day. There's a number of significance around that. The seventh time around, the seventh time around, when the priest sounded the trumpet blast, Joshua commanded the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the city. The city and all that is in it are to be devoted to the Lord. Only Rahab, the prostitute, and all who are with her in her house shall be spared, because she hid the spies we sent. But keep away from the devoted things, so that you will not bring your own destruction by taking any of them. Otherwise, you will make the camp of Israel liable to destruction and bring trouble on it. All the silver and gold and the articles of bronze and iron are sacred to the Lord and must go into his treasury. Everything in the city must die or be devoted to God except Rahab. Destruction is only one aspect of God's plan for nations. Nations do have a choice. Even a people whose wickedness is reaching a point of no return can repent and find forgiveness and mercy from God. I just want us to stay just for a bit with Rahab. Actually, let's quickly have a look at chapter 2. Verse 1 says, "Then Joshua, son of Nun, secretly sent two spies from Shittim, Go look over the land, he said, especially Jericho. So they went and entered the house of a prostitute named Rahab and stayed there. Okay? And the woman kept them safe. And when the king sent out men to look for the spies that had entered their land, she hid them. And before they left, let's look at verse 8. Before the spies lay down for the night, she went on the roof and said to them, I know that the Lord has given this land to you, and that great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to Sihon and Og, the two kings of the Amorites, east of the Jordan, whom you completely destroyed. When we heard of it, our hearts melted and everyone's courage failed because of you. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on earth below. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that you will show kindness to my family because I have shown kindness to you. She discerned that these people were God's people. And she took them on board. And there was a kind of desperation in her desire to be saved. And today, how desperate are we to be in God's favor? How desperate are we to be God's children? How desperate are we to be God's messenger? Is it like, there's time, I'm only 25 years old, I still have time? The medical progress that has been made has been fantastic. I can live up to 114. I still have long years ahead of me. The desperation to seek God's face is no longer there. And if you are sitting here this morning and you already committed yourself to God, congratulations, I'm happy for you. But if you are sitting here this morning and you are still in that mode thinking that I still have 5 years to go, let me be a young man before I give my life to God. Let me do the things of this world before I give my life to God. I tell you, my brothers and my sisters, you need to change that attitude. You need to become desperate to be God's child. Amen. There's desperation in a desire to be saved. You are not going anywhere until you are sworn to me by the Almighty God that I will be saved when your army comes into this city. We have heard of the things that you have done to the people that you came across in the past. How the Lord had opened the Red Sea so that you can cross over. How he had dealt with the kings that stood in your way. We are scared. Our hearts are melting. But I tell you what, I have spared your life. And before you go, I want you to swear that you save me and all that is mine. And the thing is, she wasn't noble. She wasn't part of the king's family. If anything, you would consider her to be someone that is not regarded in the community. So this morning you feel, I don't have money. Everything I lay my hands upon is going to pieces. Having said that, I still have 50 years at least. When I'm 49, or when in 49 years' time, plus whatever I am now, I'll give my life to God. But who says you'll be here 49 years' time? Even with all the advances in science, the doctors cannot stand before you and tell you, hey, Timmy, you'll be 120. Because he hasn't got my time in his hand. He hasn't got your time in his hand. Keep you on life support. And that's what it is, life support. When God comes, he comes. Actually, who tells you that the world will still be as it is in 5 years' time? Talk less of 49 years' time. So we need to develop the urgency. We need to move and move fast. And if you're here 49 years' time, that's a bonus. That's bonus. If you're not here 2 years' time, you go to God and sit at the right hand. If you're here 49 years' time, you have 45 or 47 years to live alive in his presence. Of course, I want to live 120. I want to see my children. But if God says tomorrow, it's time, it is time. So if God says it is time today, are you prepared to meet him? We need to develop that desperation like Rahab developed. I said, swear to me before you go that when your army marches into this city, you will save me. And that's for you today. That is for us. That is for every single one of us that have not accepted Lord as their Savior. And that also brings me to Jesus. He called all to himself. He said, I didn't come to the world to seek out those that are already saved. I have come to see those that are lost. And in that way, you have a responsibility, my sister and my brothers. You have responsibility. We need to seek out all those that are lost. Because the thing is, it beats me how those spies, those two people, those two men, went to Rahab. We need to seek out those that are vulnerable. We need to seek out those that God wants to meet with. So, Rahab got what she wanted. And on the seventh day, that's verse 20, when the trumpet sounded, the people shouted, And at the sound of the trumpet, when the people gave a loud shout, the wall collapsed. So every man charged straight in, and they took the city. They devoted the city to the Lord and destroyed with the sword every living thing in it, men and women, young and old, cattle and sheep and donkeys. Joshua said to the two men who had spied out the land, "Go into the prostitute's house and bring her out and all who belong to her in accordance with your oath to her." So the young men who had done the spying went in and brought out Rahab, her father and mother and brothers and all who belonged to her. They brought out her entire family and put them in a place outside the camp of Israel. So there's opportunity this morning. There's opportunity this morning. I'll speak just briefly about this woman again. Not only was she saved, but she was actually literally adopted into the covenant of God's covenant with the children of Israel. And the Bible tells us that yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become what? Children of God. So I don't care what your past is. I don't care what you have been through. I don't care your situations and circumstances in life. God is willing and is prepared this morning to take you on as his child. We hide under the excuse that I have sinned so much. When I was in secondary school, there was this joke going around about people that had done things bad. They said they will continue to do those things so bad that on the day of judgment, God will be so angry with them that when he looks at them, he will hold them, throw them in anger, and they will fall to the other side. But he doesn't want to hold you in anger. He doesn't want to throw you to the other side. He wants to bring you near him. He wants you to be his child. Because he sent his son to the cross for you, for me, for us, so that we can claim salvation. Children born not of natural descent, not of human decision or husband's will, but born of God. Look at all of us here sitting. There's white, there's black, there's brown, there's pink, there's purple. There's man, there's men, there are men. Men, women, young, old, from how many nations across the world? And we count ourselves to be brothers and sisters in the kingdom of God. And just look at the color here this morning. Imagine what it will be on that day. Thousands upon thousands upon millions singing and shouting and screaming, "Hallelujah!"
Amen.
I want to be there. I don't know about you. I want to be there. I want to share in that shout. I want to sing. I want to serve. I want to lift his name above all other names. Although I know that I haven't got a very good voice, I know when I start to sing, many of you will shoot out. But I believe that when I'm up there with him and I start to sing, the angels, the heavenly host will listen. They will stand up and join with me in singing his name. Consequently, you are no longer strangers or aliens, but fellow citizens. And we'll have the head of state broadcast, "Fellow citizens, I am God Almighty standing before you this morning." It doesn't matter whether you are British or Nigerian or American or from Eritrea or from Ghana or from Indonesia or from Sri Lanka or from anywhere, because you're all part of that kingdom, and the head of state will be looking after us because we are citizens of the kingdom. And the other thing that I want to bring out here, there are two strands to it. The first is the fact that there was obedience in the camp of the Israelites. There was obedience. How tedious, how monotonous. Every day, walk around the city, say nothing, just. But they recognized that God was at work. God was moving. Just as he's moving today. They recognized that his power, his authority is enough. They didn't have to do anything. All they needed was to obey him. Just as today, as children of God, all we need is just to obey him. It's not about how clever you are. It's not about how good you are at your place of work. It's not about how handsome like me you are. Yeah, I am handsome, aren't I? But it's about being in God's presence and obeying him and letting him do his will. There was total obedience. And there was faith. There was faith that this thing that God was asking of us, just walking around the city once a day for 6 days, and on the seventh day, walk around seven times, is going to be, that's what he wants. That was complete faith. So, God asks you to do things. How many times have you tried to help God along? Oh God, you need to move along. You need to move along. Maybe if I help you along, you get things done quickly. And in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, faith was ascribed to Rahab there. How she had faith that this thing that she was doing would bring salvation to her. And consequently, she was adopted, just as you and I are adopted into God's family. And today, I want us to think. To think of the deep truths, partially shadowed. Sometimes you don't see everything. Think of Christ, what he is, and what resources he has at his back. Of what are his claim for our services, our loyal, militant obedience. Think of the certain victory of all who follow him among the armies of heaven, clad in fine linen, clean and white, Think of the crown. Think of the throne for him that overcomes. The children of Israel, when they left Egypt, left because God said, I want you to leave. Abraham, when he left because God said, I want him to leave. When God told him, when he was already past it, you know what I mean? That you have a son, he believed. And I want you to think this morning that as this passage has shown us, when that God is on the move, and when he asks you to do things, he wants you to do those things. So the position that you occupy in life is a unique position. It's because he has placed you there for a purpose. And he desires you to do his will. He wants you to bring people to the kingdom. And as I said at the beginning, as children of God, every minute of our living time, we need to be in total submission to God's will and desire for our lives. And it will be great that day when we look back and say, oh, Ismat, that's you. We used to be at Greenford together. Lorraine, oh, that's you. Rich woman, you here? It would be good to see all of us there. But it needs for us to hold on to our faith. It needs us to submit in total obedience to his will so that we can cross over to the side. We can cross over. And as we leave this morning, my question to you is, are you desperate for him? And are you prepared to be desperate for him to move in your life, to touch you, to use you? Are you going to be an example to the people that you live with, that you work with, that you relate with? Are you going to see his kingdom come in your friends and families and colleagues' lives? Are you going to proclaim his name wherever you are? Let's be prepared to cross over. Let's be prepared to see Greenford Northolt, Ealing, London, Great Britain, move in God's spirit. I know we cannot do it alone, but we can start. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your words to us. We thank you because you have spoken into our lives. And Heavenly Father, we want to commit each and every one of us into your hand, that as we go out into this work, into this week, Father, you will go with us and that your anointing will go with us. We pray for the feeling of your anointing in our lives, Lord. Heavenly Father, we commit each and every one of us here present this morning into your hand. We pray that your glory will shine in us and through us. We will see your kingdom come because we will speak of your goodness in our lives. We will be light where there is darkness. We will speak deliverance into people's lives for your glory, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a nice week.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.